May 17th, 1966. Another Atlas Agena docking target vehicle crashes into the Atlantic Ocean. NASA is getting desperate. As a backup to the Agena, they launch another rendezvous vehicle known as the Augmented Target Docking Adapter, an Air Force satellite with a docking port jerry-rigged to its side. This backup, however, is rushed in production. Early telemetry indicates that its fairings may not have separated during launch. The cursed crew of Gemini 9 must rendezvous and determine a solution. The crew of Gemini 9A, the new mission to intercept and analyze the faulty satellite, consists of Commander Tom Stafford and rookie Gene Cernan. Stafford, who previously flew on Gemini 6, encountered similar problems on that mission. He will fly the approach. Cernan will then make an EVA and attempt to diagnose the issue with the fairings. Cernan is also scheduled to test an Air Force maneuvering backpack known as the AMU. On June 3rd, 1966, the pair are blasted on their mission into space.
T-minus 50 seconds and counting. We will get ignition at zero in the countdown. Some 3 seconds thereafter, liftoff will come. During that period, there will be a period of about 1.8 seconds where we possibly will have the capability of shutting down if necessary. T-minus 35 seconds and counting. T-minus 30. T-minus 25 seconds and counting. We're on an automatic sequence. Everything appears to be going well during the final phase. T-minus 20 seconds and counting. T-minus 15. T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. We have ignition.
We have a liftoff. It looked like 39 minutes, 32 seconds after the hour.
We're right on time for rendezvous. We're just exactly on the rendezvous.
17 seconds. Flight dynamics reports the thrust looks good. The roll program has started. Roll program is completed. The pitch program has started. We have a liftoff. Time confirmed at 3:09:33 after the hour.
There it was, spinning helplessly out of control. The crippled vehicle's fairings remained jutted together, under high tension from straps that were tied incorrectly on the ground. If these fairings were disturbed, they could potentially snap shut and rip a hole in a spacesuit. Gemini 9 maneuvered around the ATDA while Mission Control debated on what to do. Tom Stafford described it as an angry alligator.
Okay, both the clamshells of the nose cone are still on, but they're open wide. The front release has let go, and the back explosive bolts that attach it to the TDA have both fired. It appears that one of the bolts from the band is fired. The ones keeping it together is the front disconnect for a small electrical connector that fires the bolts on the band.
Roger, understand.
So the jaws are just like an alligator's jaw that's open at about 25 to 30 degrees, and both the piston springs looks like are fully extended.
Roger.
Now, both of the back parts of the nose cone have separated from the TDA, and it looks like it's just held on by some inconceivable force there. Everything looks good.
Roger, I understand. What type of rates have you got? How bad is it coming?
Okay, it's about 3 or 4 degrees per second.
The decision was made not to fix the ATDA. The docking portion of the Gemini 9 mission had been canceled. After a day of relaxing and reorganizing for the crew and mission control, Gene Cernan was ready to make his EVA, but he, too, immediately began having problems. After pumping his spacesuit up to full pressure, he described an intense pain in his lower back. He was unable to move very much at all. The suit was too stiff. However, Gene labored on. Working his way, handhold by handhold, to the back of the spacecraft, the primitive Gemini spacesuit, which was air-cooled, was unable to deal with the new accelerated effort being put out by the astronaut occupant. Gene's visor fogged up entirely. He was now unable to see, completely blind.
About the time that I got here into the back end of the area and started working, connecting some hooks on a tether, the sun was just about to go down. And Tom, being in the front of the spacecraft, was almost in total darkness, and I was in total sunlight. And I immediately got very warm on the back, and I'll explain this in a minute, but I got extremely hot in the back, as a matter of fact, in the small of the back area. We stopped and took a rest until the sun went down, and then we continued on with some of our task of operating and donning the AMU. About this time is when my visor started fogging up, because this in itself is your life support. The problem then started as soon as it got dark. The visor fogged up. We had conversations back and forth about this. We knew what was happening, and it was just a case of continuing on because we were not time limited.
Overworked, exhausted, frustrated, and disappointed, the crew of Gemini 9 was unsuccessful in both of its primary mission objectives. The next day, they were going home. The lesson from Gemini 9 forced NASA to reevaluate its mission planning to ensure that an ample amount of support and backup was given for each mission. And the creation of an objective review board helped to determine whether or not objectives were critical in the evolution of American skill and experience in manned spaceflight. There were 3 missions left in the Gemini program, and NASA had to make sure each one counted before they were ready to go to the moon.